is the... That's better. Hi there, I'm ewhac.
I'm gammadev.
And we're not sure what we're doing yet, but there's a copy of Road Rash in the player, so I guess that's what we're doing. And before we started recording, gammadev was telling me something about the Ducati bike.
Yeah. Well, maybe we'll... You might actually see it in here. If you actually play this, am I going to play this or are you going to play this? Who's got the controller?
Where is the controller? Oh, it's over there. It's conveniently located.
But, yeah, well, actually, and they used it in one of the cutscenes. You get to see yourself wiping out. One of these bikes is a really, 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 really expensive bike. And apparently they didn't... I don't know if they just didn't have enough insurance on it or whatever, but during the shoot... they ended up kind of destroying the bike. Or at least putting it into a condition where the company that they were renting it from would not accept it back.
So
basically, you break it, you bought it. And I'm, like I said, in one of the cutscenes, I think if you do poorly during the race, it actually shows them crashing the bike. And this bike now sits permanently in the lobby of EA. just sitting there. I think it's that one. I believe it's the yellow one. If I remember correctly, if you actually go there and you go by their gift shop and everything, a little bit towards the back of the lobby, you'll see standing very proudly amongst their display of awards and games and trophies and all the stuff, there is a full bike sitting there.
A ruined Ducati.
Complete with, it actually looks pretty good but it's like it's just scratched all the hell and there's some broken pieces on it. I don't know if they glued it back together with super glue or what the deal. But, yeah, it looks very nice until you get close to it and you go, oh.
Oh, here's our disclaimer to patronize lawyers. No, I hadn't heard that. One thing I do recognize from this is the roads.
Huh.
They shot all this up in the hills of the San Francisco Peninsula because it's clearly like 84 and 35. 35 being on the skyline, the ridge line up and down the peninsula, and then 84 goes all the way out to the Pacific Ocean. It's actually a very pleasant drive, and indeed, there are many motorcyclists out there on the weekends enjoying the road. So I don't know how they were able to get huge chunks of the road coned off so that they could shoot all this.
I'm just looking at some of the names in the cast. First of all, I'm noticing a lot of people are mentioned multiple times the thing, but I also see that some of the bikers are played by EA people. Like the project manager I recognize in there. Lucy Bradshaw, who's like, I think the last game she was in charge of was SimCity. I think she's in Nexus now. But she's in there as both a project person and also as one of the people, I guess, standing along the side of the road or something during the videos. That's not unusual. EA does that a lot. They will have FMV where they'll just basically get the entire company to show up and say, please stand along the sidelines while we have some people throw football on our fields or, you know, play a little basketball on in the court or whatever. You know?
Yeah, I was kind of part of that sort of similar sort of thing.
Dog trainer. Apparently there's a dog.
Way back when.
You might want to cancel all this.
Oh?
Just realizing... you're going to have to turn the music way down when this because this is actual the in-game
actual,
music is not a problem.
Actual licensed, childish copyright police.
So you're going to have to mute the music during that thing, but you'll notice they're like Soundgarden and a few other before they were really big bands are in there. The old grunge scene got their before they were too expensive to license for games. They were in this game. This game actually came with its own separate seat. I think I know who that is. That's a caricature of.
There's not enough to play the game music at this time. You're playing it right now.
No. Race music is different. They don't use licensed music during the races.
Oh.
So the jukebox, though, you might want to turn off the... for instance, right now you're listening to Soundgarden. You might want to just...
Jeez.
Pause. Therapy exit. So I guess there's...
apparently. All right. Well, I'll just squelch this in the.
No,
edit.
Just pick somebody who's not no longer famous.
Uh,
sure one. We'll find out. Yes. This might require two releases on the old YouTube. You might have to like mute. You might have to bring the music volume down during the UI part of this. Uh-huh.
Anyway, so
during the game, it's not this licensed music. It's during the game. It's original mm-hmm. stuff.
Oops. Wait a minute.
Because they're not streaming the music off the disc. I believe they're streaming the levels off the disc. There we go. Some wonderful FMV they shot.
Yeah. Highly colorized.
Yes.
So what? Am I in tournament mode or am I in? I don't know.
What did you click?
I didn't. That's the whole thing. I was trying to back out to the main menu and it went, "Oh, I know what you want to do." And it's like, "No, you don't."
Yeah. Remember this aesthetic was really big that they had. It's like,
I do not remember the controls. All right, so
you've got three options really here for accelerate.
All right, so that's punch, A button, B button.
Why did you think it would be one of the shift buttons?
Because there's plenty of games out there where
shift is actually for steering in this game. It's for leaning.
For leaning. Okay. Yes. All right.
Maybe if you had real triggers, I would say you would be. Yeah. You would be a thing. And remember, you actually have to.
I have to run.
It's real life. You've got to run towards your bike. You can't automatically get back on there. So.
Yeah, I'll let you play the next round.
Okay.
So they, yeah. So this one, this game, I do know they used LOD for their rendering.
And they used a lot of. I remember this one was one that took a long time to get ported to the PlayStation, just because they had trouble with the level streaming.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, getting the PlayStation to do two things at once because they didn't really have a multitasking kernel. They had to write their own to get to.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. I remember also the PlayStation version, I don't think, is nearly as colorful, probably because, again, we talked about this a little bit, another thing where it's like, you could either be two colors, four colors, or 256 colors for your sprites on the PlayStation.
That's right, yeah. They had some.
Whereas most of these are, I'm sure, like 32 or 64. They probably didn't have memory to bump them all the way up to 256, so they'd drop them down to 16 for most things, so. Okay. It would probably help with the speed on the PlayStation by, using less memory for their textures and having smaller size textures. But it always looks a little bit drab when I were playing it on the PlayStation. Plus, you don't get like on the Saturn, for instance. Also, they have a problem of like you don't get the transparent shadows under things. You get the checkerboard shadows. I would love to have them. This is like one of those games where it's like I wish they'd done a sequel because they, because this was basically their learning experience on the 3DO was this game. Yeah, they could have done wonders with this. There was an unreleased snowboarding game that they did with this engine, a souped-up version of this engine, which they'd shown. There's videos of, but they just never.
Mm-hmm.
They never really. I don't think they released on any platform. They didn't put on. It's called Shredfest. It had that same art style too.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's like the distorted characters and models and stuff.
Is this the same thing? Because I remember something about.
Might have been the 32-bit precursor to SSX. Yeah, Tricky or whatever.
Because I remember there's being some sort of big promotional thing with snowboarding because it was now an Olympic event and. 3DO or Trip or something had attached themselves to like the big name and he failed to medal or something.
Well, that was the whole Johnny Moseley thing. I mean, where he, this 3DO put out that Mad Trix Johnny Moseley game, which has the most hilarious FMV intro, which we should find a link to and put it in with this video. As well as the X-Play review of said FMV intro when they were reviewing the game. It's technically skiing. It's set in San Francisco. Uh-huh. And it starts with Johnny Moseley saying, of dubious sobriety, saying, "I wonder what would happen if it snowed in San Francisco." And then it's sort of like, I guess the rest of the game is some something-fueled dream. where you're just doing mad tricks. Down the hills of San Francisco, and you know, covered in snow. Just knock them off. Come on, hit them, hit them. Knock into the car. Oh, no.
I haven't played this in ages.
It's great if you can knock him into a car, though. You
know, yeah.
I mean, it's like always fun.
Actually, no. So, I did have... 20 years ago, I had some skill at this game, because we played it... because we played it in the lobby.
Oh, yes.
But the most hilarious thing I ever saw, sort of thing of emergent property of games... Okay, now in FMV, I'm showing you lose. You didn't come in third.
Didn't show you crashing the bike, then.
Well, funnily, I don't remember that one.
Loser!
All right.
You want me to?
Sure.
Want me to play one while you remember some emergent gameplay?
Emergent.
Yeah, see, now that I know these are like, what do you like, Pacific Coast Highway? The peninsula, see, these are all like...
Yeah.
Basically, it's like, what's within driving distance of EA?
Yes, the restroom. No. Okay. So, yeah, emergent gameplay. So, the funniest things I ever saw was after you... The cops will, like, pursue you and try and, like, they'll try and sideswipe you, and they'll actually try and whack you with their truncheon. Okay. And so there was one instance where... we're racing along, and I don't know if it was me driving or somebody else, but they hit something and they flew off their bike at like 500 miles an hour or whatever it was. And so they're tumbling along the road while the cop is like keeping pace with them. And then while he's tumbling along the road, the cop goes whack, whack, whack. Pulls out his truncheon and starts beating him up.
I don't think I've ever driven Pacific Coast Highway, at least along the actual coast. I've been on it for other parts, but I've never actually had the opportunity to drive along it and actually look at this view. Yeah.
Well, it doesn't look exactly like this.
Well,
I don't think you're
less pixelated, I'm sure.
Yeah, it's just like, they'd have to redo this now because Devil's Slide is gone and it's been replaced by a tunnel. Ow.
Oh, wait a minute.
Collision? Hello?
If you go through it slow enough, it's fine.
There, see, that's a new tunnel on Highway 1.
That's very nice that they change your sound when you go in the tunnel there. Very nice. Using the remarkable power of the 3D.
It's the immortal power of the 3D. They're able to predict the future.
I assume a lot of the tunnels in here are probably too like high loads or whatever.
I don't know.
Like, there's your transition from...
Yeah, from
the background.
Seaside from, to, yeah. Yeah.
Technique you still use today. Although, it turns out if you never actually hit your opponents, they won't usually try and hit you. Most of them, it's like, they basically hold grudges, which I thought was kind of nice. There's a little bit of AI in these things. Whoa. So there's your level of detail you're talking about. On the roads there, then you'll see, like, if you get far enough off, you'll see... Yeah. Whatever. Now, is he going to go specifically after me?
He always goes specifically after you. That's what I thought was kind of cheesy. Is like, if you knock off another guy, he doesn't go after him.
No helicopters at this point in history, right? This is before OJ made helicopter chases popular. Oh, no, this is slightly after that. That's right.
So you were mentioning that sometimes the EA will have a bunch of people, like, by the side of the road, just as, you know, extras.
Yes.
I was kind of part of like that a long while ago.
You can pick a path there. You can go left or right.
Oh, that's true. I had been invited as a guest of somebody when Lucasfilm was having like their annual picnic out at the ranch, out at the Skywalker Ranch,
right?
Which was very pleasant. And one of the things they had, they said, okay, everybody come over here. And so, like, you know, there's like 200 people all gathered around, and there's this sound guy. Yeah. He says, okay, we need cheering for Howard the Duck.
Sure, yeah. Why not?
And so at the end of Howard the Duck, when they're cheering Leah Thompson,
whatever, oh, says, yeah, yeah.
I'm in there somewhere.
I know the music. Yeah, I know the movie.
Yeah. I'm in there somewhere.
Oh, you want to have a most embarrassing credit contest? Because, which ties a little bit into the whole, like, history, 03-0 and the whole thing. Somebody on our last up, wait a minute, did I win? Is that one?
Wait, there. Yeah, I believe you did. Yeah, it sure looks that way.
Ah.
There is one, I do remember one scene, in a losing scene, where a bike simply just falls over. I'm wondering if that's what you were referring to earlier.
Well, there's one FMV where they actually crash the bike. You actually see the bike slide on its side. And I said, wow, do they really... Now, it might have been the fact that they'd already wrecked the bike, and so they said, let's just shoot a shot of it sliding, because it's like, well, we're paying for it anyway, so let's get some money shots out of the thing. Uh-huh. But you want to try another one? Well, they don't let you see... Nowadays, they'd let you see all the different movies or whatever.
This never had a two-player mode, did it?
You want to try, what, Napa, maybe? Peninsula?
Sure, the wine country.
Peninsula. This one did not have a two-player. Again, that's one of those things where it's like, if there had been a sequel, they would have probably done it. Yeah. Would have figured out how to do split screen or something.
Well, they might have done it in other parts of the country.
But, well, that too. Yeah. They also somewhat ported down this version to, like, the Genesis or whatever. There was already a Road Rash on the Genesis, but I don't know if they called this one Road Rash 2 or 3 on the Genesis, or gave another name. But it's basically these graphics scaled down. Because they had the same maps and everything. And so. Now, one thing I say they're kind of clever with, apparently during some production of, I thought it was this game, or maybe it was the 3D sequel they did later, they actually came up with a car rig that actually would drive over the roads and take pictures of, like, road textures and such.
Huh. Sounds like Google Maps.
Yes.
Excuse me. Pardon me. Excuse me.
Yeah. Although not nearly as good, but I also noticed also that they motion blur the textures.
Yes.
Which looks great when it's going like this. When they're stopped, though, it doesn't look so...
No.
They should have, like, switched out the textures for, like, non-blurred versions. And stuff. But, somebody... Remember, last week we were talking about, like, shooting FMVs on video, and they said, you know, digital... They might have used a digital camera, and somebody commented on that, saying,
yes.
It's like, no, it's really... Yeah. Well, okay, so the reason why that sticks in my mind, I thought that might be the case. Yes, Digi Betacam cameras are out in 93, right?
Uh-huh. And they were Zarking expensive.
So, yes, they were Zarking expensive, but... That was... So, 92, 93, when I was working at a small CG house, 92, 93 is sort of like basically when the atomic blast went off in the whole entertainment industry, that basically digital had arrived in a big way.
Uh-huh.
So, there was like a whole... Oh, I don't remember being... Yeah, I don't remember the dirt path. I just never bothered. I assume that's one of those forking paths or whatever.
Yeah.
Huh. I honestly don't remember ever driving along a dirt path in this game. Did you have to go through, like, a barricade or something? Or
no.
But I remember,
of course,
like,
there's pedestrians.
Yeah, what the hell? I guess these are power walkers out or something.
Yes.
But, so I remember, like, 93 in particular, where sort of, like, everybody was big into digital production. Like, there were a lot of, like, high-profile things, Jurassic Park, for instance, that come out.
Yeah.
That year before actually was also big for SIGGRAPH for digital production. Where, as somebody in the effects industry said, the switch from optical to digital, because it was not a slow dissolve. It was a quick, it was a hard
cut.
Yeah, smash cut. Where literally it's just like, okay, that's it for opticals. Just shut them all down.
Wow.
Like SIGGRAPH, that 92 was just all about digital production. And then 93 was sort of like it hit fever pitch because Jurassic Park had come out that year.
Uh-huh.
And SIGGRAPH, for those of you know, it's sort of like E3.
Yeah.
Except it's devoted entirely to computer graphics.
Yes.
But it's also you know, commercial vendors and but also scientific papers and
all
that stuff.
Now wait, 93. I remember a SIGGRAPH production that Lucasfilm did, ILM did, for the Indiana Jones.
Young
Chronicles.
Indiana Jones, yes.
So was that the bellwether? There?
That was another one. That was actually because that was everybody remembers like Jurassic Park that year, but also there was quite a few other big things like. There was a big motion capture breakthrough they had that year, which was they could do sensorless motion capture. Claim had come up with it, where you could do it just basically now, which is pretty much how they do it anyway, which is they have a room just surrounded by cameras, and they're able to coordinate them to track everybody. Before that, basically, people had to wear suits.
That's kind of how Phase Space does it.
But
Tracy McCherry's company.
Before that, pretty much you had to be wired up physically. You had these little magnetic...
With the little ping pong balls and...
No, ping pong. You literally wires on your thing of like little magnetic...
Oh.
Sensors.
Oh, that. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And so that was very constraining. And then that was one thing. But yes, George Lucas or Lucasfilm did a thing about the Young Indiana Jones Chronicles, basically a little TV series. For those of you who don't know, quite a nifty one, where basically it was like George Lucas says, "I want to make this series as cheaply as possible, but it's got to look like a big budget, like we made a big budget movie every week."
Mm-hmm.
And he basically did it guerrilla style. I think they shot everything in 16 millimeter.
Mm-hmm.
But then would digitize it.
Really? 16 millimeter?
Yeah. And they said for some shots, they even got away with 8 millimeter because he wanted to make this as low budget as possible. And so they did basically only use local. They shot all over the world, but they used local crews, local directors, local talent for everything except for like their main stars.
Mm-hmm.
And so, which is why you had this weird eclectic mix of directors who worked on the thing. Like, hey, there's an episode directed by Terry Jones because it took place in England, so why not get Terry Jones? Yeah. Mm-hmm. To direct an episode of the thing and make it all period. But of course, it was a period thing, which obviously was a problem. Mm-hmm. And so they did this wonderful reel at SIGGRAPH where it was like, wow, that's really nice footage, but where were the effects? And just as you literally are saying that, they rewind the thing and they go back to the beginning. They show you every effect shot and you're like...
Show you how they composited it all together.
Where it's like, oh, they weren't really in a street in New York. They, you know, painted that. Oh, there weren't really 30 people there. There was really 3 people there and they just used clever digital manipulation and moved around a bit. And my favorite one was the one... it's just a long tracking shot where they're... I think it was actually handheld, where they're following the main character, Young Indy, backstage.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just the camera's on him the whole time. You're like, okay, what the hell's the effect in this shot? And then they show you the original film and they put a big circle around a guy who's standing right behind him, yelling stuff in his ear. And he goes, lose this guy.
Yes.
And then it like shows like the shot, you know, without the guy. And it's like a little counter that says rotometer.
Yes.
Where it's like how much that cost them to do that? It's just like, And that was one of the people where everybody in the audience just laughed and they also got a little scared because it's like, wow, they don't like you. They can just completely replace you out of the movie.
I think it's your turn.
Oh, am I playing that? Okay. But yeah, that was like, and also Death Becomes Her, where there was a lot of things where it's like, oh, we're not going to fix it in post. We're going to do it in post.
Uh-huh.
Where, you know, suddenly it's like, oh, we have these wonderful shots where it's like, oh yeah, we couldn't get these things together, so we just thought, oh, we'll combine them in post, and it's perfectly seamless, and you don't notice it. Let's see,
I just did Napa Valley. You did Pacific Highway, so I guess Sierra Nevada's left.
Okay. But so that was a big thing where it's like the movie, like Death Becomes Her, actually won the Oscar that year for visual effects. A lot of people don't remember it, but it's kind of funny because it's not what you consider to be a big budget effects movie.
Right.
But it has probably more effect up to that time, more effects shots in it than you would ever realize. And most of them are invisible.
Hmm.
And that was the big thing about it. It was like, you know, yes, there's some obvious ones like where Meryl Streep's head is on backwards.
Yes.
Yeah, so but that's an obvious one, but there's like a whole bunch of little things where it's
chest,
like, oh yeah, like, you know, this little vial, you know, make it stand up. We just, you know, we didn't bother making a fancy rig. We just put some calipers on the thing and then just painted them up digitally. And people's like, you could do that? And it's like, you see, like, directors' eyes just light up when they saw that. It's like, I don't have to sit around for days like try and rig up some invisible wires and stuff. And that was another thing that, like, the year previous was, like, Terminator 2. Had a lot of stunt work in it where it was the first time they didn't have to hide the wires. They could actually remove them.
Hmm.
Nowadays, that's no big deal. You can do that on, you know, free software on, you know...
Yeah.
On a freaking Android tablet or something. But, yeah, so... where they painted the, and so normally they do invisible wires and they throw a stuntman out a window or something. Now it's like they showed like these big thick orange wires.
Which then get chroma keyed out or
they just, you know, remove it. Yeah. Just paint it out. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Somewhat automatic, you know. So.
Yeah, look for the long straight orange thing, get rid of it.
Yes. And, you know, stuntmen originally liked that, and then they realized, hey, we could just have digital stuntmen.
You can tell they don't move right. That looks like a Havoc ragdoll physics. Okay.
Yeah. Well, see, I always hate that when people say it's like, oh, well, CG is terrible. You can spot all the time. It's like, no, you can spot bad CG all the time. Uh-huh. But if it's good, you can't spot it. I mean, that's always been the thing about special effects. It's sort of like, you know, Harrison Ellenshaw was saying, like, you know, he worked on Empire Strikes Back. Amongst other things, and he was saying, you would tell people, you know, he was a matte painter, and somebody said, oh yeah, I saw those 3 paintings you did. It's like, yeah, I actually did about 80.
Yeah.
But it's like, you know, you spotted 3 of them, okay.
Yeah.
It's the ones you don't spot, I'm proud of, you know. Like, like, you know, like I said, Death Becomes Her, I bet most people don't notice 90% of the effect shots in that movie. There's a lot more just, like, really simple things that until somebody points them out to you, it's like, wait a minute, how are they not seeing the camera? This room is full of mirrors. And it's like, well, because they digitally painted it out the camera. Very simple.
Oh, just have the software guy.
Yes,
do it.
You can notice that, you know, obviously Meryl Streep has a CG neck when her head is on backwards. Because, yeah. Because, first of all, how else would you do it? So you're looking for it very carefully.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, it's like, you also probably didn't notice, like, oh, yeah, they also, this did not take place during the day. This took place, you know, they had to change up things, or, you know, they made it so this was safe so that the actors could do this, or, like, one of the more subtle things that they didn't, well, not necessarily subtle, not, you know, to look for it, Jurassic Park, where there was, like, a shot where they're escaping the raptors and they're clawing to the ceiling, and what's her name, Lexi, falls through one of the ceiling vents, and, you know, there's a brief shot where she looks up, and it's her face, but it's not her doing it, it's a stunt woman doing it.
Oh, and they put her face on
it. And they just digitally pasted her face on it, so when she looked up, because originally the stunt person wasn't supposed to look up.
Right.
They thought they'd wrecked their shot.
Uh-huh.
And then they said, oh, let's just try pasting her face on it and see if you can do it. And
it's moving fast enough anyway. Yeah. It'll probably be okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Huh.
And now if you look at it, it's like, wow, Lexi's got some guns. You know. Because it's a stunt woman. It's not... But... You know, now that's an obvious version, but even, like, the same summer, what was it, Last Action Hero?
I still have not seen that.
Yeah, I'm really not missing much.
Well,
it's a parody kind of thing.
I kind of should see it because it was written by a friend of mine.
But one of the better examples
that I haven't seen in years, David.
Another one of the examples. Oh, is this, she's going to...
No.
It's the same losing one.
Yeah.
Or is it a slightly different losing one? She goes after the real guy. Oh, not there. But, again, this was one of those, clearly because from the year before they said, oh, you can do anything with digital after Death Becomes Her. They'd had a shot on Last Action Hero where Arnold, he blew his line. And didn't realize, it wasn't so much that he blew his line, he blinked at the wrong time.
Oh.
I think that was it. And so, and then also his lips didn't quite match what he was saying he needed to say when they redubbed it.
Mm-hmm.
So, they just went in and digitally moved his lips to match the correct line and also to remove his blink. And somebody says, wow, you can make Arnold's acting better through digital technology. Some point, it was like, it was cheaper to do that, even though digital was still somewhat expensive at that point.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you couldn't quite do it on somebody's laptop at that point. You still need expensive, you know, workstations to do it. It was still cheaper than Arnold was per second, you know. So,
at that time.
Yes. Well, yeah, nowadays. Nowadays, he's like, you know, he's eighth person build with... Stallone and Willis and Dolph Lundgren and Jet Li.
This is a half-read headline from a tabloid. I think he's doing infomercials now for nutritional supplements.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Really? Well,
I'm probably wrong. Please check me on that.
But... maybe in Japan. He's always big on that. But now he's in like Expendables, whatever, you know.
Yeah. Just, you know, oh, hi, I'm here to pad out the credits.
Yes.
Careful of the box rule.
Let's
see.
So. Peninsula?
What else? Have we done this one?
Did we do Peninsula?
I haven't done it, but, well, I don't know.
Is it good? I didn't do Peninsula.
Oh, well, I didn't either. So,
then it must be done. Okay. All right. Well, yeah. So that's why my head sticks. Like, because like I said, working at Effects House, we were doing mostly all digital production with one exception, our HD. We were one of the few HD recording facilities on the West Coast.
Oh, wow.
Basically, well, actually, I think we were one of only two. It was us and Sony. There was one on the East Coast, but we were using, at that time, analog HD. Because that's all you could get. This was before the SMPTE standard in the U.S. had been finalized, and there wasn't any digital equipment, and there wasn't a U.S. standard. So this is 1080i, 60.
Wow. Oh, yeah, 60i.
1080i, 60 frames, and these are analog, reel-to-reel tapes. So
wow.
But we were...
repurposed old quadra scans? Or?
But everything, But everything else was digital, so we had, like, a digital... Laserdisc recorder, digital Betacam, all this stuff. So we were doing a whole bunch of quick digital stuff. That's why I thought, oh, these guys probably got a hold of a digital camcorder because it makes everything so much easier for your productions if you have everything in digital.
What? Interesting. I rear-ended the guy. I fall off my bike and he just carries on. Hey, look, a telephone booth. Another historical anachronism.
Kids, telephone booths. That's where Superman used to change clothes. And so so you were in Howard the Duck. You worked on. You were.
I'm one of several hundred voices in that one bit.
Sound recording. I've been in a couple of video games where that's true. They just get everybody. It's like we need everybody to say like rhubarb, rhubarb. Or,
oh right, yeah.
It's a Japanese video game, so say bok choy instead. but no, so that summer, so that like 93, big summer, 3DO comes out in fall, Jurassic Park comes out, Last Action Hero comes out, and got crushed by Jurassic Park. You know what came out a few weeks before those? Super Mario Brothers the movie.
Oh, dear Lord.
Guess who worked on it?
Oh, do tell.
Oh. Yes. Okay, so, like I said, small CG effects house I was working at.
Yeah.
We were doing research for a Dr. Seuss movie. All the places you'll go. The producer on it was Roland Jaffe. We were doing basically tests of combining 2D hand-drawn animation with 3D backgrounds. Trying to get that Dr. Seuss look.
Yes.
This would have been... May, I guess. Roland Jaffe comes in and goes, you guys really need to help me. So Super Mario Brothers movie had been in production for about 2 years. They had their own effects company set up specifically for the movie.
Yeah.
They had been working on the effects for a year. They'd gone through multiple directors. The current two directors, the guys who did the Max Headroom TV show, are now vacationing in Hawaii. They'd completed their work, and they were just like...
We're done.
Done, yep. The climactic effect shots for the big finale, the showdown between the Mario Brothers and Dennis Hopper as King Koopa...
Okay.
...had not been done to any real degree. They showed us what they had, and so I don't know if you've seen the movie.
No.
Okay. Most people haven't.
Right.
But you really should, just for historical purposes.
Jim Sterling do a review of that.
Oh, dear God. anyway, so basically... It's set in New York originally, and then through some trans-dimensional warp, they get transported to a place where the asteroid didn't hit and dinosaurs rule. But they're evolved dinosaurs, so they look like people.
I see.
They're ruled by Dennis Hopper. He plays King Koopa.
I see.
Blah, blah, blah. He wants to invade our dimension for no real good reason other than the fact that his place sucks. Because it's this burnt out, post-apocalyptic, looks not bright, colorful in any way, shape, or form. Looks nothing like the movie. Oh, to the victors go the spoils. Okay.
As it were.
Yes, kids, misogyny was alive and well in the early 90s.
It still is. Just check any internet chat
for
him.
Yeah, I don't know if you get away with that too much today.
Yeah.
Certainly not in a T-rated game.
It's playful enough. Anyway, so Roland Jaffe.
Okay, God, yes. All right, so one of King Koopa's big weapon that he's going to use to invade Earth is the Devo Ray. Insert jokes here.
All right.
Devo is not in the soundtrack, although it should have been just for that.
Yeah.
Mojo Nixon is in the movie for some bizarre reason, but okay. The Devo Ray, which devolves people.
Right? I see.
Yes. So, like, briefly, he invades New York for all of, like, 1 minute,
mm-hmm.
and he turns a guy into a monkey. A chimpanzee, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Before he's sucked back to his own dimension, and then the Mario Brothers face off against him. They get a hold of the Devo Ray, mm-hmm. and they devolve him, first into a T-Rex, then to, like, a coelacanth, and then to primordial ooze.
Uh-huh.
Lots of flashing lights and all this stuff.
Right.
They shot the live-action plates for this. There was a big-ass rubber puppet
mm-hmm.
for the T-Rex.
Yes.
There was a little hand puppet for, like, a devolved version of it.
Mm-hmm.
Looks like it's made out of rubber. And then on the live-action set, they poured a big bucket of green ooze onto the street, and that was supposed to be his final phase.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they had for live-action. The effects guys that they had, oh, dear God, basically took those three live-action elements and did the cheesiest 2D morph that you could do in 1993.
Mm-hmm.
It was bad for 1993. It looked like somebody did it on a 1993 Macintosh.
Ooh.
Yes. I wouldn't, ooh. Like, my Amiga morphing software was better than what they used at that point in time, because we were using some of it at this price. I was doing, like, for a little quick stuff, I was using like, some of the Amiga software. and it was literally like, watch the rubber puppet just squash down out of frame, and then suddenly there's green, it turns greenish, and then no way looking like liquid anyway. Uh-huh. Sure. And then cut to
and then
crossfade.
Yeah,
it wasn't even a crossfade. I mean, it was not that sophisticated. And you're really like, this is what these guys had a year. These guys came up after a year. Are you effing kidding me?
Wow.
And so we're like, okay, you want us to fix this for you.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Do you still have the puppets?
No, we don't. Oh, we couldn't do that. We were going to do it completely CG. So, which actually, so the reason they also came to us was the company I'd worked for had done prior to Jurassic Park had mm-hmm. done some really famous short films, which were considered like the best CG dinosaurs done because mm-hmm. they had really good muscle movement on them, and because they used a parametric render using metaballs. So,
mm-hmm.
where Jurassic Park was very brute force in terms of like. They had these really high-res polygonal meshes, and they had a zillion people working on pushing and pulling and mm-hmm. making and hand-painting out all the rendering errors and glitches of polygons penetrating each other and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
This was their stuff. The short films they had done were done by a handful of people.
Mm-hmm.
And like maybe like two artists and one engineer, two engineers.
Mm-hmm.
And so they had some experience with doing this. So they're like, okay, when do you need this? 10 days. Has to be done 10 days, and it's like 30 seconds to a minute effect shot, which even today would be really, really pushing it.
Yes.
even with all the wonderful advances in technology and CPU power, to get something
uh-huh.
usable in 10 days. So it's like, and I was basically the only technical guy there.
Oh,
I did absolutely anything that involved a keyboard.
The digitally technical guy.
Yes.
Okay.
So, no, I mean, I did everything from IT to we need to automate this script. We need to somebody to rewrite the recording software. The artist can't figure out how to do this. Can you do math? You know, kind of can you fly? So, but they already had
can
the
you
software.
Swim?
Yeah. So basically, my producer looks at me and says, "Well, I hope you brought your sleeping bag. You're going to live here for the next 10 days." And it's like,
man.
And this is Los Angeles, that's actually a reality because it would take me an hour commute each way, and so mm-hmm. if anything goes wrong, I have to be there on site. So I was like, and she made it to me. She bought some toys. I was a cheap date back then. I think I got quite a few games and a few mm-hmm. electronics
mm-hmm.
as a little bonus every day. I was like, here, look what I got for you. How's it going?
Okay.
So, so basically it was like round up the, because we didn't have the hardware to do it either.
Right.
I had to go round up computer workstations and crunch, basically make a render farm. Like, okay, that was my first job that afternoon, make a render farm. Second job,
round
up. They had to go grab up. They had to go actually import a few hotshot artists from Japan to come in and quickly do, who were, you know, skilled with the software more than the local guys, so and had done dinosaurs in the past. And so basically they got them, you know, first plane over, they're there, they put them up. It's like, hey, we have a hotel for you, but you're not going to use it. So, and you know, everybody's, so we're getting all those stuff together, rendering. And so basically, yeah, spend a whole week on that. And so when the movie came out, I was like, oh, I actually did not go see it in theater. But our producer broke it to her. She said, oh, the company's only going to allow two names on the credits from our company. Huh. And so I said, okay, that's fair. So I figured they would be the two main artists would get the credit. And I thought, okay, fair enough. I understand. My first movie credit. It's so awesome. Then I saw the final film. So glad I did not get my name in the credits. But I was somewhat pissed when I did see the movie.
Effects by Alan Smithy.
Yeah. I did see, because the people weren't the two artists who got the name of the credits. It was the producer and the president of our company. And I'm like, they didn't do... So, I was very glad not to have my name on the credits. But yeah. But the funny thing was, I literally saw about a dozen versions of that movie over the course of those 10 days.
Really?
Because every day they would bring in multiple cuts of the movie. And each cut was radically different. I'm not talking like, oh, let's shift things around. I mean, literally, there were whole plot lines that would just be in and out. There were whole different, and the other weird thing is like, there would be whole different takes of like one dumb joke. One was like the fact that there's the two Iggy and, I can't remember the freaking name.
Lenny and Squiggy? What?
Iggy and Spike or whatever. Basically, they're two of his minions who he then sent to New York to get the princess who's escaped. As a child, blah, blah, blah. And they had this ongoing joke that these guys didn't understand that hot dogs weren't actually dogs. They thought they were dogs. And they were upset whenever they'd eat a hot dog and found out it was a dog. And this was like the dumbest joke ever.
Yes.
But I literally saw four different versions of that joke done where there was like, one is they're in a cab being, and they're doing it. One is they're walking down the street and they come across a cart vendor. And it wasn't like it was an on-running joke. It was one time the joke was in the movie, but they'd shot it all over New York, this one joke. And I'm just like, God, this movie must have cost a freaking fortune. If they're doing multiple setups of one stupid little joke.
A live shoot.
I can't remember what actually the final version of the movie ended up with in terms of like, because like I said, there was a plot line of like, her father was devolved into fungi, and he's like the Mushroom King. And there was one version where he never got re-evolved back. He was just always fungus. And there was another version where he gets evolved back, and it's actually played by Lance Henriksen for some bizarre reason. And I can't remember what final version is, but it was whole stuff like that where it was just like there would be whole plots just in and out. And I'd seen things like people say, it's like, I don't understand what this is in the movie where there's a... It was like a plot where, like, if you put people into, like, the Goombas are, like, these big, huge guys with these little tiny dinosaur heads.
Yes.
And you find out in the movie that he does this by sticking them in the Devo machine and just shrinks their head, their brain.
Just
whatever.
Devolves their head.
I guess, yeah. And there's another thing where there's a part about where they, if you put them in there, like, a second time or left them in there too long, their head would just turn to green slime and he would just kill them that way. It's like, seems like a really expensive way to kill somebody.
Yeah.
But there's like versions of that movie I've seen where that's not in there. So there's this inexplicable scene where they're in that chamber and there's a green splat on the floor where the guy had been killed or something like that.
Huh.
And it was just really weird seeing how much footage they had and how many versions of that movie. Should we be playing here?
Yeah, I'm kind of letting the game on the wayside here.
I know. But it was just funny where it's like, oh, wow, that movie was just so freaking out of control. And you could see them, like, literally day after day trying to save it in the editing room.
Because
these weren't little
these
tweaks.
These guys had edit droid.
These weren't, they were... Oh, yeah. Yes, yeah, absolutely. These were... Because these... And you know, they would just bring by... Every day they would bring by, you know, tapes of, like, well, here's the new cut of the movie. And it's like, I don't know why they bothered doing that.
Right.
Because we only needed... We only need that one scene. It's like, I don't know. I don't know if the producer is trying to share his pain with us or something. It's like, looks what I've got. But it was just really fascinating seeing where it's like such radically different cuts of the movie day to day.
Yeah.
Where this, like, you guys aren't really a, this is like chaos theory. Are you basically hoping that eventually
we'll just keep throwing the dice until we get, like,
I mean, yeah, it's, yeah, like, are you hitting the randomize button on the edit droid or something? Because they weren't refining, they weren't approaching anything. You were just like cut after cut after cut.
Wow.
It was, like I said, it was scary and funny at the same time. But yeah,
you got some goodies out of it.
Yeah, but it was most embarrassing movie credit. Thankfully, I'm not actually in the credits.
Well, I think we've played all five tracks available to us. Do you want to throw something else
is
in?
Is there a brief?
You can throw one of the sampler discs. It keeps wanting to go to the music videos, and I keep trying to stop it from doing that.
Oh, is this my original one?
Shockwave?
Oh, yeah.
Smash cut.
Smash cut. Hey, start up with Shockwave. Wow, I did not know any of that.
Sometime I bet you the entire movie's on freaking YouTube. Because I don't know if there's actually been.
There's a DVD release, a director's commentary. That would be
there's
hilarious.
There's a DVD's release of certain. Uh-huh. Oh, God, you will never get those two directors to sit down and talk about
that. Hey, they
movie.
Stole my thing!
A 3DO experience.
Yeah.
But yeah. Because, yeah, like I said, they went through multiple directors on that thing. Mm. And then the two they ended up with, I don't know if they ever did another movie after that. Because they were kind of up and coming. Because, like I said, they'd done the Max Headroom TV series. They'd mm-hmm. done a remake called DOA with, like, Dennis Quaid. And it's like, they were known for very stylized stuff. Mm-hmm. And it was one of those things where I thought, oh, maybe if we get an interesting director, and there's a husband and wife team, maybe that will mean something.
Big and scary.
Yes, before there was Wing Commander 3, there was this of, like, it's the perfect fusion of movies and games. It's a cinematic experience. Whoa,
we've only got
2019, Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
When are we going to get our flying aircraft carrier space carrier?
Yeah, orbital platform.
This is what happens when you defund NASA.
We interrupt this broadcast to bring you a special report. Good evening. Unexpected meteor showers have been reported over...
Now, isn't that guy, like, an actual news guy?
I don't know.
I remember when I watched this, I thought, either this guy's doing a really good impression of somebody, or this is like they just got a local news guy.
I don't know.
Hey, look, they put a calibration bars right in the... Now, this is an example where you say the Cinepak actually helps.
Yes, the Cinepak actually made it look better.
Unidentified flying objects approaching Earth.
Plot their approach vector and sound red alert.
Because it just looked like cheesy chroma key footage when you saw the raw video,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, but there's something about the improved contrast ratio that makes it look even worse. It's like you said a long time ago, the soap opera effect.
Yeah.
It's a little bit like that.
Somehow. Call up the pilot roster.
All right.
Who can we get in the air now?
Easton. Just got in today.
Thank God. We'll need John. He's as good a squad leader as it gets. Who else?
Now, if this were a Japanese-made game, there would be blood type. It would be on there, too, of, like, their stats.
Oh, really?
Like, for some reason, they always include, like, blood type. Okay, I don't know why.
In case they get injured, you know.
I don't know. But,
you know, you want, like, two A's, you know, two type A's, so they can, like, you know, transfuse each other if they get hurt.
But in combat, who knows?
Oh, we stand a fighting chance with this crew. I just hope that the kid...
Now, see, if they did a modern remake of this, they could use, like, your Kinect to take a picture of you and insert your frame into there instead of saying, image not on file, we haven't emailed it up here yet. That'll take at least 2 or 3 days to get an image file up here. Now, is that just a comment on how...
Lieutenant, this is not a drill. Your mission is active reconnaissance over the Nile Delta. Heavy alien activity reported at Giza and Cairo. No. Set recon scanner for auto record.
Apparently the lights on the bottom there.
I think that's missile count.
No. What? You'll see it when you actually start.
Omaha will send us a refueling drone just before we reach Giza. My first scans already show alien signals among the ancient ruins on the shore.
This was another thing I think they had a little problem with on the PlayStation was this briefing during So some of the lights apparently on our show.
Oh, frame rate?
They show streaming
activity.
I think it's like the bottom most blue lights.
Okay. Oh, there we go.
Don't shoot the sailboats.
No. I'm trying to remember the controls.
They had an issue of like on the PlayStation version. I don't know. They had an issue like showing the movies while they're loading the levels.
Huh.
The cockpit movies. For the briefing, they had to like tone it back a bit.
Yeah, apparently you can destroy the pyramids of Giza as well.
Yeah.
Okay, what's this?
And the one in Las Vegas too. I always love when she says
that. Aha, they're so hilarious.
She always says that. It's like you're breaking the fourth wall or something.
Really? Why do I have these cheesy ass controls? Yeah.
Hello.
Thank you. Oh, I mentioned earlier, but I'll mention for the audience as well. So in our last video, you mentioned Star Control 2
yes.
in the 3DO version. And then you mentioned that there was a remake called The Urquhart Masters. Well, yes. I went and downloaded it. And I've been staying up until 3:30 playing it. It's a pretty darn good game.
We'll have to do Star Control, but that'd be very lengthy. We could maybe just do like the first encounter on that, because that's a very lengthy game. But,
mm-hmm. Oops. Ah, okay, now the flying Watsits.
Again, another first-generation game that they did pretty well on. The Shockwave 2 is actually really... You could see how much they'd improved their understanding of the platform. It's kind of...
Hello.
It's kind of sad. Although Shockwave 2 suffers from one problem, which is I don't like the first couple levels.
Mm-hmm.
Because one's like a land-based mission, and you have this kind of slidey hovercraft thing, where I'm just like, and it's kind of a maze. And
oh, right, and yeah.
It was like...
Oh, he collided with me. That's
they got,
not
they got wonderful technology, but it's like you still have to get into the whole,
oops,
you know, hook them on the first level, or people will never find out how great your game is later on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, he's outside the barrage zone, so just keep.
Are you using your
apparently
using your radar there?
Yeah, I am. No, it's the flying guys that I'm in. Yeah, just a minute ago you were saying this isn't a game, Lieutenant, so. Okay, so now where's the refueling drone?
The aliens you failed to destroy are circling back and heading for Cairo. I believe they're redeploying to meet us further on.
Oh, this. Oh, and I've got a story about this. This game.
Oh, I think I know that. Okay.
The programmer who is working on this.
Yeah. Okay, I know where this is going. Okay.
came in one day, and I'm out of laser energy. Came in one day to use the prototype, and. He said, I don't understand why my
refueling drone is still in the air.
Really?
It's just ahead.
Thanks. He was having trouble getting the stuff to line up.
Right.
Docking with the drone is easy. Just fly in under it, staying aligned.
Ah, thank you. So he comes in, he's trying to think that his geometry isn't lining up. And so... I had trouble with like you know lining up geometry before, and so he's doing all his tests on the prototype, and I said, well, have you checked that your math is correct? And he goes, well, it works on the Mac. And I went, what do you mean? And he says, well, look. And then he stops the prototype. Can I do this multiple times? I think so. Yes. He stops the thing running on the prototype, and then he launches this program on the Mac. That is, I guess you might say a test version that runs on the Mac. And he says, and so here's this thing running entirely on the Mac using no 3DO facilities whatsoever. And he says, see, it looks fine. And I'm kind of going, seriously? Because the 68,000 and the arm have very different multipliers. The arm is 32 by 32, and the Mac, the 68,000 is 16 by 16, yielding a 32-bit result. So any numbers that you get in your projection matrix are going to be a little off if you're assuming that this is that everything is going to be the same.
Don't get cocky, kid.
Stop interrupting my conversation. Anyway, so this poor guy comes in and he's going like, yeah, it's it works on the Mac. It's like that's not really proof of anything.
Yeah, he works on my machine defense.
Yeah. Although it didn't
hey, tank. Not how good that tank is doing. But yeah, I'm guessing that was the basis of the Pippin version of this.
They won't appreciate that.
Did you just shoot something of theirs?
I think I actually bumped into one of the oil reservoirs.
Oh, darn.
It's their own fault for putting it in the middle of a war zone.
Should have gone green.
It works for me.
All this nice desert land you're not using? Put some solar panels down there, dude. Come on.
Surviving alien forces seem to be retreating to Cairo, so it is critical that we destroy all forces in this location.
Dun, dun, dun.
Excuse me.
I can't remember if Shockwave 2 had music or not.
I do not
recall.
They upped the
production value since it was...
There was music in the cinematics.
Yeah, but... It seems odd that they didn't put any music in the game proper.
Come on. Do you think I'm hitting the pyramid?
Probably. Why?
I'll do zero there. Oh, shit.
Isn't that a refuel drone? Like,
yeah, there is.
You're shooting your shots down.
All right, where are you?
You also missed.
Yeah, there's one. There's a guy back in the back there. Yeah. Is he still in range?
Nope.
Huh? Yes, he is. Goodbye. Used to be much more efficient at this. Hey, guys.
You've achieved your second mission objective by clearing Giza of all alien forces.
So they seem to be able to shoot your missiles down, but you can't shoot their shots down.
Well, I am using the cheesy-ass laser.
No, I mean, when you were just left with, when you only could do missiles.
I believe it's their command center.
Oh, yes.
It's like there's just no way to avoid getting hit by their shots. They just seem to shoot straight at you. I don't think you could actually dodge them. I remember completing this. I don't think I completed Shockwave 2 or Operation Jumpgate. Speaking of the expansion pack.
I did complete the second one. I think I'm in the same boat as you. Yeah. If you shoot them in the head, they go down faster.
Really? Headshots work on these things?
Yeah.
Or maybe just not hitting them because you're hitting their legs. They're not hitting their legs.
I'm detecting aliens we have already encountered. Forces that we failed to destroy have regrouped here to reinforce their attack fortress. Destroy this headquarters, and you will have secured the Cairo area.
Uh-oh. Oh, that's right. Yeah. Yeah, he really lets loose.
Yeah, his range is slightly less than yours, so you can...
I think it only takes 3 missiles to take him down.
Hope you save some missiles.
Okay, more than 3.
I might want to shoot him as well. Yeah.
He's out of laser range.
Is he?
Yes, I'm pretty sure, as I recall.
Yep. Yep. You got missiles at that point? Dun, dun, dun.
Major, I'm finding that the patient suffers from rotator cuff damage and severe hydrocarbon contamination.
In other words, a dislocated shoulder and smoke inhalation. Finish patching up the kid. I've got Hangar 1 waiting.
I'm the doctor here. The pilots require more than just hit and run medicine.
Excuse me, doctor, but I'm the flight controller here, and we are trying to win a war. Get Wildcard to Hangar 1 now.
Yes, sir.
He's a little pissy. So we have to. I can't remember if you have to do the whole thing over again. I think you do.
Yes, you couldn't make Boomer like do cleanup. Like, can he give you a few missiles there? What was it? The fact that Boomer has his name on a piece of masking tape on his helmet. It's like
gaffer's tape.
Do they only have one helmet, or are they just saying, "Yeah, these guys are pretty expendable, so no point."
Your mission is active reconnaissance over the Nile Delta.
Aha! I can make her shut up. Okay.
Coming back to Egypt for another attempt.
I'm trying to remember what it was. If it's the ones on the right, the green on the right side, or if the little blue ones that are indicate the streaming status.
Just destroy all the invaders and try to leave the civilian sites intact.
Like, yeah, the ones to the left.
Yeah.
Like, indicate buffer activity.
Mm.
That green vertical thing that's on the left just keeps going up and down.
Because
notice as you speed up, it'll... Right. You're going outside.
No, I'm going over here so they'll all be kind of lined up.
Dun, dun, dun. The fast forward option on YouTube. Careful. Your ship seems a lot wider than, in terms of... Well, I guess it's supposed to look like at the time, the unseen stealth bomber... Nowadays, everybody knows what a stealth bomber looks like.
So much for that secrecy thing.
Well, they kept it a secret for a long time. Even on aliens, headshots work.
We're coming back to the Valley of the Kings. It's vital to eliminate the alien buildup here.
Scrape off the alien buildup.
This is like Mr. Monster.
They really did do a nice job on this. On the flight mechanics. Yeah, I know. Shut up.
We don't have any political data out there. You'd be lost.
Yeah, I like the way they justified that. It's just like, it's a rolling barrage falling behind, going behind you, so if you...
That you never see, but okay. Yeah.
Hey, did they just spontaneously...
run into something?
Yeah.
I think so.
All right, and then a walker here. Yeah, we weren't ripping
off. Just a little War of the World-ish.
Yeah.
See, this is where I'd love to have the total eclipse shockwave weapon, just like a big sweep forward. Like, little Death Blossom action there.
You're doing just fine.
Yeah, thank you. Just want to tell you both good luck. We're all counting on you.
Where are you? There you are.
Great work. You've cleared the Valley of the Kings. Your first mission objective.
I think the sound effects also contribute to that movie style feel where you hear like the bangs in the metal, which definitely didn't hear on earlier games. Like,
would you shut up? I'm trying to watch my radar here. Oh, hello.
like, we paid this guy, we are going to use him.
Fine, just use him. Just don't have him, like, block the status display.
The refueling drone is waiting for us just beyond the rise.
Waiting. Try not to shoot it.
Yeah. Winning.
To dock with the drone, simply fly under it. Alignment is critical.
Hello.
See, I'm just watching you play, and I'm just like, no, don't do it.
Let's fill up again. There we are.
Yeah, it would have helpful if they had the rolling barrage, like you could see, like just, you know, getting hammered by fire outside the.
Well, if you roll, if you stray outside, then you will get hammered by. Come on.
You can sort of take this as an update to an earlier 8-bit game. Was it Sky Fox or whatever? Maybe a little Rescue and Fractus, although I think Sky Fox... Was Sky Fox an EA one? Is that...
Sky Fox?
Or is that Broderbund?
Wait, where the hell am I?
You're getting hammered to get it off path. And...
Star Fox is what I'm thinking of. Yeah. That's Nintendo.
Egyptian army units are still fighting in the oil fields. Stay clear and then...
Who made Sky Fox? Was that EA?
Jeez. Yeah, guys, just walk behind him.
No, not Star Fox, no. There we go. Sky Fox. Sky Fix, Sky Fox.
Oops. Okay, you coming back? Good.
Seriously, Moby Games can't. If you say Sky Fox with a space in it, it can't find it.
Oh dear.
But it's like, come on. You know what I mean.
Oh, hello.
Our second main objective, Giza, is directly ahead.
Does the Sphinx actually show up in this?
No.
Doesn't?
No, I'm pretty sure I do not remember the Sphinx showing up.
Oh wait, I'm thinking of it does, but not here. Shows up in the Las Vegas level.
Oh.
You have the Luxor and they had a little Sphinx in front of it. Which you can of course blow the head off of and everything.
Really? That's all the laser energy you have for me? Oh, that's kinda lame.
Oh yeah, Skyfox, Electronic Arts.
Oh, is this like a version of Arctic Fox?
I think Arctic Fox is a sequel to Skyfox.
Well, there was correctly. Arctic Fox for the Amiga.
Skyfox. Yeah, it was released on the Amiga.
Which Alan Hastings, he did something really hilarious. He basically put his 8mm camera in front of it and like stop framed it. And he stopped framed it because the frame rate on Arctic Fox is really abysmal.
Well, it was 8-bit. What do you want? Right?
What? No, this is on the Amiga.
Oh. But anyway, yeah, Sky.
And then he played it back and it looked great. It's just like, wow, this would be great if the frame rate wasn't like 5 times.
Yeah. Sky Fox, I'm pretty sure, is the original one. It started on like the Apple II and stuff, but they did. It was right at that point where you could be on the Amiga.
Mm.
So. It was one of those, you know, transitional things from 8-bit mm-hmm. to 16-bit. But yeah, I'm pretty sure Sky Fox series. Yeah, I'm pretty sure Sky Fox was the first one. I think Arctic Fox was the second one. Nope, Sky Fox. Sky Fox 2. And then... So what was the year Sky Fox was released? 1984.
Hmm.
Sky Fox.
So
we've made it to Cairo, our final mission objective.
Arctic Fox, 1986, so yes.
Yeah.
That's a sequel. Well, I'm guessing after Sky Fox 2. Yeah, when I see that cockpit, I immediately think Sky Fox.
Mm-hmm.
Or Rescue on Fractals.
Yeah.
But, yeah. They got more elaborate in the sequels for this, where it was like... Like, if you died, they had like a robot surgeon, I think, in it was the second one, or Operation Jump Gate. And occasionally you would see, like, you know, blood dripping from, like, a saw or something. And then the robot's kind of looking like, whoops, I didn't mean to do that. I'm trying to, like, just, like, put you back to sleep and stuff.
Yeah, we're not done. Here. Where's my giant hovery thing?
The visitors, the V or whatever, the V ship. They're not your friends, no.
There are a lot of aliens ahead. Their advance forces have regrouped to defend a massive attack fortress.
Really? I thought.
Destroy this alien command center, and you'll liberate the whole Kylo area.
Thank you, soothing computer.
Because yes, once the aliens are gone, there'll be no problems whatsoever left in the Middle East. Yeah.
Aliens are clearly missile, the problem with
can you
it.
Fire missiles and lasers at the same time?
Well, you can, as I say, the... Yeah. The, he's out of laser range, so...
Serpentine!
Yeah.
Get out of there! I tell it.
Damn,
is he not firing? Is he not firing at you this time?
I'm just keeping it... He hasn't, that's right. He spins faster the more damage he gets. Yeah.
Yay.
Wee. Oh.
On the...
Ta-da-da. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
Dun, da, da.
Our final mission objective has been achieved. Destroying the alien attack fortress has left them confused and leaderless.
Ooh, it's early Siri.
Good strike, Warpad. Israeli and Egyptian forces are mounting a counterattack over.
Except it provides useful information.
So, yeah, clearly that's an absorbing game.
Dun, da, da.
Dun, da, da.
Here's a summary of your combat performance over Egypt.
See, this is a little better
through
than
the ages. We've looked to the stars for our gods and saviors, hoping to find some kindred souls who could explain to us the secrets of the heavens. And now they're here, and they brought our apocalypse.
I forgot about this.
Yeah, I did too.
Did they? Are they reading quotes from War of the Worlds?
I don't know.
Against sports fans, it's going to be a long slide into home.
All pilots have reported in, sir. We've made it through round one.
What about
one.
Boomer and Starbuck?
Yes, Dr. Lawrence.
I've studied the initial scans from Moscow and London. It's very strange. The aliens are using some sort of chemical agent. Those exposed seem to be in a state of shock. No reactions. Not even to explosions or falling debris. Air samples are inconclusive.
Keep on it. What about civilian channels?
Take a look at this.
Reports are coming. Apparently, this is the only anchorman in the world.
Well, yeah. Nice ladder.
For some reason, I'm still framed off to the right. To leave.
Could
to leave
you scooch for, over a little?
Yeah, to leave room for a thing that's never going to be there again.
Reading a book about a goat. Well, no politics here. Come on. Wait, 2019. Who will be president then?
Escape the effects of toxic chemical weapons. We've locked our doors here in the studio and we'll remain on the air as long as we can.
Yes. Oh, locked doors will stop them. Apparently they're the aliens from Signs or whatever.
Yeah.
Almost all airfields Maybe we can get in. Oh no, they've barred the doors with wood. Why didn't we bring any tools with us on this invasion? Yes, they can't open pantry doors. Yes.
No.
Sophisticated aliens. Water hurts them.
Yeah.
Maybe they should have thought of it before invading a planet entirely covered by water.
Water falls out of the sky, for crying out loud.
We can't go through this. It's wood. Oh, no. Let's go up to the windows. Oh, no. Wood. They're remarkably efficiently built. As few polygons as possible, sir.
Yes.
Looks like it's up to us.
All right.
So, where are you supposed to be in this? Because they can, their excuse is, oh, he's just transferred, so his image isn't on file. But you would then be in that briefing there.
Yeah.
Are you supposed to assume that one of the people that you haven't met yet, like, you know,
apparently there's no way to pause this.
Oh, Peru. I forgot about Peru.
Yeah. South America.
Yeah, but I think that thing on the left side is...
There we go.
...is streaming activity. The green on the left there.
Mm-hmm.
The up-y-downy thing. Like bufferful or something.
Yes.
Dun, dun, dun.
Yeah.
It's clearly a different level now, as you can see by the greenery.
It's all green now.
Yes.
Well, God, I should check. Hang on while I stand over the recorder.
How long have we been going?
Yeah, I'd call that an episode.
That's an episode, yes. Shockwave and Road Rash.
And
early EA.
And
first generation
effects.
EA.
No. First generation EA is Archon and Pinball Construction Set.
This is their christening into the wonderful world of 32-bit.
Yes.
Multimedia streaming and CD-ROMs and such like that. You know, basically, this was the console that they cut their teeth on before moving on to the PlayStation and then realizing, oh, God, I wish we had an OS. It's writing your own OS is hard.
We got such static from the gaming community when they said, oh, how can I get your OS out of the way so I can get speed and performance?
Yes.
And we said, you can't.
Yes.
Because if we're going to move forward on hardware design. And in fact, the cost-reduced CD-ROM drive, we took full advantage of that. We were able to completely swap out the CD-ROM drive with a new manufacturer, new interface protocol, that sort of thing, and virtually none of the software noticed. Mega Race noticed, yes.
Well, I think
because they were streaming unlocked off the drive, and so when the drive got faster, the video got faster. So they had to like hack around that. But
yeah, there were a few games that had problems with like compatibility with like Gold Star, you said you might look at the one later. Mm-hmm. PO'd, I guess, apparently had different seat characteristics or something that messed up something, I guess.
Could be. But that would have been impossible if they'd been doing bare metal programming.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Gave the 3DO a couple extra years. And a couple of extra manufacturers.
Well, yes. But, that helped. Where's that AT&T console?
Where's that Time Warner console?
I'll tell you the AT&T joke after we cut off.
We'll just keep that one to ourselves, but thank you all very kindly for joining us, and we look forward to seeing you next time.